Hey, good morning, y'all. I'm not even from Texas. Hey, big favor. You guys want to move this?
No.
We're super prepared. We're missing Ben. Hi, if you can hear us, Ben. We love you. Enjoy your family. I'm not used to introducing us, so here we are. If you want to stand with us, I don't know the announcements. They're going to be up here, or they were, so check in on the website. Totally on the fly right now. But let's worship. That I know how to do. So stand up with us. I just was going to share real quick. I was worshiping in my kitchen. I shared with the team earlier this weekend with these songs that we're going to do, and I just fell apart. So I'm going to share this with you. Darkness does not wear a name tag, and the enemy does not knock first. And if he does, he doesn't announce himself as the enemy. So it's on my heart heavy. If we are a believing church, if we are filled with the Holy Spirit, we have to be aware. We have to know what's coming. We have to pay attention. We teach our daughter all the time, any of our kids, the bad guy doesn't come up to you and say, hey, I'm here to hurt you. He doesn't do that. Joy shared this morning, when the enemy speaks to you, he speaks in your words. He says, I am ugly. I am whatever. So if we're not aware and not paying attention, we're going to miss it. And a church, a believing church, this is really heavy on my heart, guys, a church that is believing, who believes in the God that is sovereign and capable of healing, capable of bringing us to heaven, right, of wiping it all clean, that God is still the same. So if we're a believing church, we believe in that God. He knew this was all happening. If he was sovereign, this isn't new. So we have to stop as a church, not specifically us, you guys, but the church, behaving as if this is new information. This is not new. He already told us how to respond, and we have to move in that faithfully. So these words wrecked me, these songs this week. Can I hope they take us all there. So go for it, Jackie.
To
The darkness tremble. If we're living in the light, we shouldn't be afraid. So if we're afraid of anything, we're not living in the light, because he makes the darkness tremble. Amen? Which means we should live out joyfully. You will love this one.
Now the clouds have sinned and
this last one, this is prayer time, so you're welcome to sit. I'm going to say it. I am praying that as a church, we would not be afraid to continue to lay hands on people and pray. That is important, and it makes me sad that we're afraid of that because it's powerful. That's the God that we serve. He heals. We should not be afraid to lay hands and be the church and pray over people. This is an original song. We've done it for you before, and it came with a vision of a flood. I hope that you catch it. It's definitely poetic in that it's a flood that's, he's coming like a flood, and he's not going to miss one crevice, and he's going to make it all new. A vision of his kingdom to come. So I hope you enjoy. You're coming like a flood to refresh the weary soul, to wash away the old things and give life to what is yours. You will not miss a crevice, not a crack within the floor. You will fill every promise, pour it out, oh Lord. Behold, you are making all things new, all things new. I'll write these words down in my heart, they're true, God, they're true. We should not be surprised, God, that this world has come under. Instead, fall on our knees, but you haven't given up. Can't pay for redemption. No, we can't thank you enough. What you are about to do does not rely on us. Behold, you are making all things new, all things new. All right, these words. Because that's what we were built to do. God, we were put on this earth not to serve our own rights, our own desires, our own self. We were put on this earth to bring you glory. You are bigger than anything we face. Bigger and more important. And I pray that today we would put our rights aside, put our fears aside, put our pride aside. God, I pray against solitude. We cannot do this without each other. We cannot do this without being arm in arm. Lord, you are worth it no matter what comes. We love you. We praise you for this morning, for a chance to sing your name, to lift our hands and declare that we're yours. We praise you for the message we're about to hear. I ask that you bless it and anoint it. We love you, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning. Good morning. Good morning. Okay, there, I'm on. Thanks, Ivy. Thanks, praise team. Well, happy new year. It's 2021, and that's strange to say, and it's hard to believe, right? Would you guys agree? Feels weird to say, right? 2021, happy new year, 3 days into the new year. Real quick, a couple announcements before we start. I believe next week after church, I think starting at noon, is Aurora Palms 101, I think. I signed up for it because I haven't been to one, so I thought it'd be a good idea to go. So that's next week. That is Sunday the 10th, right? I'm trying to find the text from Pastor Ben. Yep, Aurora Palms 101 next week. You can sign up online. Also, it's the first Sunday of the new year, and it's also the first Sunday of January, the first month of the year. So normally we would do communion after service, but because Pastor Ben is gone on vacation with his family, we're not going to do that. We're going to delay that until later on, all right? So if any of you were expecting that, just know we're going to put that off until he comes back. So we're going to pray, but before we pray, let's carry on with the tradition of having everyone stand as we read God's word today. We're going to be in 1 Peter chapter 1, and we're going to be going through verses 3 through 9. So six verses today. The first letter of Peter, the first chapter, verses 3 through 9. And we should have it on the screen. We're going to have it on the screen in different slides, but if you guys can follow along with me now, we will read and then pray and then get going. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. According to his great mercy, he has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you, who by God's power are being guarded through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. In this you rejoice. Though now for a little while, if necessary, you have been grieved by various trials, so that the tested genuineness of your faith, more precious than gold that perishes, though it is tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ. Though you have not seen him, you love him. Though you do not now see him, you believe in him and rejoice with joy that is inexpressible and filled with glory, obtaining the outcome of your faith, the salvation of your souls. Pray with me. Father God, thank you for this day. Thank you for the life that you give us and the life you give us in Christ. Thank you for a living hope that you call us to hold on to as we sojourn through this world, the days that we spend here on this earth. Let us not waste them for things that do not last, but let us use our time here to know you, to glorify you, and live for you. Lord, I pray that you would remove me and speak to us, your people, through your word, and that you would bless this service today, that you'd be with our pastor and his family as they are away. Keep them safe, Father, and bring them back to us safely as well. And I pray that you would be with this church, this body, through 2021, Lord. We look back on last year, and it was strange and difficult, and the reality is we don't know what this year will hold, but we do know that you promise to be with us. And regardless of what we see or what we experience, we have this hope that you call us to cling to. And we thank you for that. In Jesus' name, amen. So, again, it's good to be with you guys. Thank you. If Pastor Boone is, he's probably watching this on the live stream, right? Probably. So thanks for letting me preach, giving me the opportunity to do that. If you want to know, because I thought, I was kind of curious about this, we're 2.5 days into 2021, and If you would like to know how long it's going to take us to get through this year, to 2022, I actually did the math for you. And I can't guarantee that it's going to work out, but I think it's pretty easy, pretty basic math, right? So we've got, 362 days left to go after at midnight tonight. And that actually comes out to, I did the math here, comes out to 31,276,800 seconds. So you have 31.2 million seconds left in this year, and then it's 2022. So what they said was true. When you're young, time goes by slow, and the older you get, it goes by faster and faster. And the funny thing is, you don't stop noticing that either, right? It's crazy. It just keeps going by faster and faster. So what we have today is a brief look at the first chapter of the letter that the Apostle Peter wrote to the elect exiles of the dispersion in what is now modern-day Turkey. And these were probably not, or at least the majority of them were not Jewish believers. They were Gentile believers that had come to know the gospel. And Peter is writing to them and explaining to them this great, this message of hope, of living hope. And we're just going to dig into it. And I feel bad because I had to pick a section of 1 Peter when the reality is there's so much here. It's hard to pick and choose what you're going to preach on. But I've been going through this myself in my own time with the Lord, reading and studying. And it's been really good, and especially timely with the circumstances of this past year and what we have, I think, in our hearts, looking forward to this year, hoping that things can normalize a little bit and get better. But like I said in the prayer, the reality is we don't know what's going to happen tomorrow. We don't know what's going to happen throughout those 31.2 million seconds of this year. So we would be wise to look to God's word and to see again the promise of living hope that we have through Christ and through his resurrection. So we'll dive in now. The first verse, Peter writes, "Blessed be the God," well, this isn't the first verse, the third verse. I would encourage you, by the way, to read this book, or at least read this chapter sometime today and get the full picture of what Peter is saying. But we're just going to look at verses 3 through 9 today for the sake of time. So verse 3, he starts by saying, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. According to his great mercy, he has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead." So the first thing that you see here is this praise and recognition unto God's merciful hand. And indeed, God's final attitude to those who are in Christ, who are believing in Christ, who are trusting in his work for salvation, the very attitude of God to all of us is mercy. I confess I cheated a little bit. I was looking at a commentary, and I found a quote from Charles Spurgeon, and it's just too good not to use, so I will share it here. Spurgeon writes, and this is an excerpt from a larger writing of his. He says, "It is from the mercy of our God that all our hopes begin." So Peter sets the tone here, and he lays a foundation for the living hope that he's about to discuss. And he explains to us that it doesn't come from anything else but God's mercy and his grace in raising Christ from the dead. Paul writes in 1 Corinthians 5:17, "If Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile and you are still in your sins." So again, this is a foundation for the rest of the text. Our living hope is a byproduct, a result of God's mercy towards us through the resurrection of Christ from the dead. And he attaches the word "living" to the word "hope." And I think there's a twofold meaning to the word "living," right? First of all, the hope is alive because Jesus is alive. Going back to 1 Corinthians 15:17, again, if Christ is not raised, then we are most to be pitied, and we're also still in our sins. So our hope is alive because Jesus is alive. Those two things are inextricably linked. You can't separate a living hope from a living Savior. And the other thing about this living hope is that it is imperishable. So there's two reasons why he calls it a living hope. One is it depends on the living Christ, who is living now at the right hand of God, interceding for us. But also because there's something durable and everlasting about this hope. It doesn't fade away. And we'll get into that further on. The other thing I want to point out about verse 3 is that if God has caused us to be born again into this living hope, it also means he wants us to have it. It's not supposed to be elusive and hard to grasp. It's supposed to be clear and visible for us to walk after and to seek. I think it's God's desire and plan for us to take hold of the living hope. It's part of his purpose for us. Verse 4, he calls us to an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you. So what is the living hope? Now this gets a little bit difficult to ponder and to explain. The mysteries of heaven and the new heavens and the new earth are difficult to grasp. Peter doesn't describe in full detail what the inheritance, what the living hope is, because he doesn't even know himself. And we know that we live in a state in which we cannot see exactly what we hope for. But we do know a few things, and I think we know more about what our living hope is not than we do about what it is, in one sense of the idea. And I'm going to use Paul here to help flesh this out. Paul writes in 1 Corinthians again, this time in chapter 13, verse 12, "For now we see in a mirror dimly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, then I shall know fully, even as I have been fully known." And again, in 1 Corinthians in chapter 2, verse 9, he says, quoting from another passage, "But as it is written, what no eye has seen, nor ear heard, nor the heart of man imagined, what God has prepared for those who love him." So, it would be nice to know exactly what heaven is going to be like, or rather, the new heavens and the new earth. Because as we sang, right, or as Ivy mentioned, Christ is making all things new. He promises that he will make all things new. He is doing that now. And he also says, the God's word says that Christ does all things well. But we don't get a full preview of what the new heavens and the new earth will look like. And I think we would do well also to look into what God's word says about not so much heaven, being with God in spirit, but also what he will do when he comes again to fully inaugurate his kingdom and to raise up a new heaven and a new earth that will be free from sin, and where his people will live in full right relationship with him. Just think about that. Think about that for a few minutes. What does a world free from sin look like? That's really hard for us to imagine because our lives are completely saturated with sin. We can't even imagine that. I don't think Peter could either. But we can ponder the idea of it, and we can recognize its value, and it gives us hope and great joy. So we know a few things. We know that there will be no more sin, and there will be no more death as a consequence of sin. Death is a consequence of sin. And there will be no more pain. Pain and suffering are also consequences of death, of our mortality that we are born into, which in turn are a consequence of the fall of sin. And though we can't really construct or fully realize what this kind of world will look like, we can think about it and we can rejoice in it and we can understand the idea to a certain point. And so the experiences of sin, death, and pain will be gone in our new, in our inheritance, what God calls us to hope in. But also, we will, I think, understand why these experiences took place. I think we'll have questions answered, and we'll understand and see in right perspective why suffering has occurred. And we'll see that God truly, as he is working them out now, in the future, we'll see that he has worked these things out according to his will for our good, even the things that in the moment seem difficult and are trying. Moreover, we will be with the Lord in fullness of joy. We'll be in his presence. And I think this is really the core of the inheritance, right? This is the core of our living hope, that we get to be with God in fullness. We get to see him. We get to know him. He will be there. We will see him as he is, and we will be made like him. We'll be completed in Christ. And again, this is something that we cannot understand here, but we can at least understand the idea of it. And his word gives us a brief glimpse into this. Last week, I was really surprised and also excited that Pastor Ben decided to go through Psalm 16. If you remember Psalm chapter 16, it's really hard to pick a favorite psalm, right? But for me, Psalm 16 would make the short list. And if you remember, and you don't have to turn to this, but I've bookmarked it and I'll read it for us here. In Psalm chapter 16, in verses 5 and 6, David writes, "The Lord is my chosen portion and my cup. You hold my lot. The lines have fallen for me in pleasant places. Indeed, I have a beautiful inheritance." And I think that inheritance is not so much David receiving favor from God while he was alive on the earth, even as a king, even as someone who sought to know God after his own heart, who loved the Lord. I think the inheritance that David has in mind is being with the Lord in the fullness, in the fullest sense of what that actually is, which we can't comprehend now. And it's the same inheritance promised to us. We know that these things that we will inherit, even though they might be hard to see now or make out now, that we know that they'll be unaffected by time, sin, or depletion. They cannot be damaged, they will not depreciate, they will not decay, and they can't be taken from us. You think about something that's imperishable, right? It's subject to time, to decay over time. You think about something that's undefiled, right? That's something that's stained as a consequence of sin. And I brought up the 32.2 million seconds as just an example of how constrained we are in this world by time. We cannot escape it. It's part of the reality that we have to reckon with every day. And as a result of the fall, sometimes time is our enemy. Sometimes we have to strive against it. Think about buying a new car, right? You buy a new car, and as soon as you buy it and take it out on the road, its value starts to diminish. It starts to go down. You hear that word depreciate, and you think, oh no, the value is decreasing. But these things that were promised that we will inherit in Christ, they cannot be taken from us and they will not depreciate. The value of what we will receive and what we will experience when we are fully with the Lord will be the same forever. I think it will actually increase in eternity. Verse 5, moving on. And he's referring again to us, Peter is referring to us, to the people that will receive this inheritance, that are called to this living hope. He says, who by God's power are being guarded through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. So God powers our faith. We're not capable of sustaining our faith without God's presence in our lives. We are not capable, we cannot sustain our own faith without God's presence in our lives. It is his gift to us, and we should exercise it, but he is the one who sustains it. He's the author and the perfecter of it. And our salvation, in one sense, is not even complete yet. Christ is even now interceding for us, right? The writer of Hebrews says in chapter 7, verse 25, consequently, he, referring to Christ, is able to save to the uttermost those who draw near to God through him, since he always lives to make intercession for them. So Christ is in heaven at the right hand of the Father, interceding for us now, even as we sin as believers. We're not perfect. He is interceding for us now. He is saving us now, even. The work on the cross has been done. The resurrection has already occurred. Praise God. But Jesus is even now interceding on our behalf before the Father. And that is part of what I think Peter means when he talks about being guarded through faith for a salvation that is still not fully revealed to us. So Jesus is guarding us now. Until salvation is fully revealed, we must exercise our faith. By drawing near to God, he draws near to us and he will strengthen us. And think about this. What good is a secure inheritance unless the person who will inherit it is also guarded and kept secure? So we should rejoice knowing that God has something amazing planned in store for us when we are with him at the end of this life in eternity. The promise is that that will be kept secure for all of us. But what about getting there? What about getting to the inheritance? Is there a promise of security in the time between now and when we arrive to be with the Lord? And there is. Jesus is guarding us now through our faith that he gives us and that he will complete. And so what are we to do with this reminder, with this word from Peter? So if we go down to verse 6, we see that he says, in this you rejoice, though now for a little while, if necessary, you have been grieved by various trials. So we're supposed to rejoice, right? We're supposed to rejoice that we have this inheritance, this living hope that will not put us to shame. We're supposed to rejoice amidst the trials and the suffering. And this is not a lesson or a sermon on suffering. That's a difficult topic. But I think it's worth covering for just a minute here. I'm sure that we've all experienced suffering. We can imagine suffering. We can come up with examples of suffering. But sometimes I think it's a little bit difficult for us to define suffering. We can experience it, we can recognize it, we can think of examples, but we may struggle a bit to really narrow down what suffering actually is. And this is a just for the sake of time, I'm going to say that the idea of what suffering is for us today is simply this. It's when something happens to us that we don't want to happen. Very simple, right? Suffering is simply when something happens to us that we don't want to happen, happening. And so perhaps one of the problems we have with the idea of suffering and the idea of suffering and trials in our lives that we would experience is because we don't understand it, and we also try to avoid it instead of trying to understand it. We are creatures of comfort. We seek things that are comfortable. We are attracted to comfortable things. We are inclined to that. We're not inclined to do anything that's difficult. And so we try to avoid suffering, but when it comes to us, because we can't avoid it altogether, right? We live in a broken world, and we're going to experience it at some point. We don't know what to do, because we've spent most of our time trying to avoid it and not preparing for it and not seeking to understand why it would happen to us. If you think of Christ, Jesus, he suffered, right? He suffered for us, and his suffering was not wasted. And if I have to be the bearer of bad news, then I'll do that. It's in God's word. But we are called to suffer. That is God's word to us. It's not just a warning, it's a calling as well. Sometimes it's even necessary, right? Peter says, if necessary, you have been grieved by various trials. If you go further into 1 Peter, into chapter 2, in verses 20 and 21, you'll see he writes again, "For what credit is it if when you sin and are beaten for it, you endure? But if when you do good and suffer for it, you endure? This is a gracious thing in the sight of God, for to this you have been called, because Christ also suffered for you, leaving you an example, so that you might follow in his steps." So if Jesus suffered for us, and we are called to follow in his steps, we should expect suffering in some form or fashion at some point in time. It doesn't mean we go seek it out. We try to avoid it if we can. But there are times in our lives where God will call us to a place where suffering is inevitable, and we have to know how to deal with it. But why? Why does God do that? What is the purpose for suffering? And what is the purpose for it here in this passage, in what Peter is explaining to the church or to these people? So if you look in verse 7, he says, So the question is, why suffering? Why is it necessary? And the answer is, so that the tested genuineness of your faith, more precious than gold that perishes, though it is tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ. So our faith must be proved. It must be tested. Think about this. What good is faith if it's not tested? Somebody could go around and say, "I have great faith." But if their life never contains anything that proves that faith or that tests that faith, do we really know if what they're saying is true? 2020 was a strange year for everyone and a hard and difficult year for many. And I'd be willing to bet that some of you have suffered in 2020. Some of you have gone through trials. Some of you have experienced grief from those various trials. But if you have gotten through those trials, if you are coping with those trials through confidence in the promises of God, then your faith as it is being tested is also being found praiseworthy and honorable, and it glorifies God when everything that you have in this world is pushed away and all you have left is faith in the promises of God, in his goodness, in his promise to be with us here on this earth, no matter what happens, and his promise of eternal life in Christ, if that is all you have, if that's all you're clinging to, then your faith is not only being tested, but I think it's passing the test. It's being proved worthy and valuable, and it glorifies our Lord. Another thing, through these various trials, we are supposed to learn something, right? We have to learn something. Why suffering? Well, it's because we have to learn something from it, right? I don't think anything that we experience in this life has to be wasted. And so, what we see here, especially in the next two verses, I think, is the sufficiency of Christ in the middle of suffering. In the middle of our faith being tested, we are supposed to learn afresh and anew the sufficiency of Christ. That through faith in him, we can know our Creator and learn how to be brought back into right relationship with him. That we can be forgiven of our sins and walk with God. Again, if I go back to last week, Psalm 16, at the end of that chapter, at the end of that psalm, David writes to the Lord, "You make known to me the path of life. In your presence there is fullness of joy. At your right hand are pleasures forevermore." I think that understanding the goodness and the sufficiency of God in Christ, and when suffering comes and causes us to recoil from putting hope in the things of this world, from wasting our lives and our time in the things of this world that will eventually pass away, when he brings things to wipe the slate clean, to make it difficult for us to trust in the things of the world, he's doing us a great favor of grace by reorienting our perspective into what is truly imperishable, into him, himself, his love, his goodness for us, the very fact that we were made to know God and enjoy him and live with him forever and love him and experience his love for us. I think suffering serves a purpose to wipe away the things of the world that would distract us from that core truth. If you guys are following with the New City Catechism, if you're familiar with that, the first question is, and this comes from catechisms that have been around for centuries, but the first question asks, what is our only hope in life and death? And the answer that it gives is that we are not our own, but belong body and soul, both in life and death, to God and to our Savior Jesus Christ. That comes, the scripture that inspires that is Romans 14, verses 7 through 8. It says, "For none of us lives to himself, and none of us dies to himself. For if we live, we live to the Lord. And if we die, we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's." Experiencing trials, grief, suffering, loss, I think this is meant to remind us of this truth, that we belong to the Lord and he is our only comfort in life and the core of our inheritance in death, which is eternal life with him. Again, God is doing a work of grace in our lives when he pulls us away from something that will not last in order to point us towards something that will, namely his love, himself. This tempers and hardens our faith and should cause us to wait with great expectation and praise for the coming of Christ and the full establishment of his kingdom. And we move on to verse 8, and Peter changes the tone, and I find this so encouraging, and we all should find this so encouraging. He says, "Though you have not seen him," referring to Christ, "you love him. Though you do not now see him, you believe in him and rejoice with joy that is inexpressible and filled with glory. That line, that passage, that verse 8 right there is amazing. It's hard to comprehend, but it's so worth pondering. Though you have not seen him, what is that? What does that mean? Remember, Peter had seen Jesus. He had seen Jesus Christ, God in the flesh. But these people that he's writing to and all of us who are hearing his word today have not. We have not seen Jesus in the flesh. But we have the same hope and the same access to the inheritance that Peter had, even though we don't see Christ in the flesh. Remember back to Thomas, right? Peter's fellow disciple. He was not around the first time that Christ reappeared to his disciples after the resurrection. And when they told him about the resurrection, he didn't believe. He was the one who was doubting. And then Jesus appeared again to them when Thomas was present. And he has Thomas place his hand into his side and see the scars on his hands, and to know that this same person standing before him now was the one who was crucified and who was buried. And Thomas had said he would not believe in the resurrection unless he had seen the Lord. And so John chapter 20, verse 28 and 29, there's a dialogue here between Thomas and Christ, and he says, "My Lord and my God," after he has seen the Lord and touched his wounds, Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." So these last two verses, verses 8 and 9 in 1 Peter chapter 1, should be just as encouraging for us to hear as it was for these believers in Asia Minor that Peter was writing to. The reality is that none of us have seen Jesus, yet we believe in him and rejoice with joy. And we are, that's what we're to do. It's almost like an imperative or a command. Even though we haven't seen him, we are to believe in him. And that should result in joy. And joy inexpressible. What does that mean? That's strange to see the word inexpressible next to joy, because joy by its nature is an act of expression. It's normally tied to emotion, to happiness. So why does he say it's inexpressible? Perhaps because the expression of joy equally corresponds to the object that causes our joy. We cannot fully express our joy until we experience the fullness of it. And we will not experience the fullness of it until we are united with Christ in the resurrection. But we can begin to express it as we begin to know him, as we begin to know our Lord. And one day it will be fully expressed when we see Christ. So our joy is only inexpressible for a little while. At some point in time, we will have that fullness of joy, and it will no longer be abstract or imagined. It will be fully there and expressible. And I want to go back to the phrase, a little while. A little while is comforting. We see it in in verse 6. "In this you rejoice, though now for a little while," talking about suffering. I find it nice and comforting to see that Peter, the apostle of Christ, tells us that our suffering will only last for a little while. And on the opposite side of that coin, our waiting and our expectation for the inheritance that God has called us to will only last a little while. We're not going to be waiting forever to be with the Lord. It's only going to be a little while. And we should all find that comforting and encouraging. And that should result in praise to God. He finishes by taking all of these truths that he's conveying to these people and telling them that by believing in Christ, even though you don't see him, and by rejoicing in Christ, even though sometimes that joy is tainted with sorrow and suffering, you are obtaining the outcome of your faith, the salvation of your souls. He says that in verse 9. So finally, we're reminded that by exercising our faith, by believing and trusting in what is unseen, in Christ who is unseen now, results in our salvation. And even though he is unseen, he's not unknowable. God has given us everything we need to know him and to follow him in his word. And isn't that what faith is? It's hope in something that is not seen. Hoping in a promise that has yet to be fully accomplished. Faith is not merely believing in God, but it is believing God. It is believing his word and his truths that he has revealed to his people. And so, as we conclude here, maybe some of you here, and really all of us, should be reminded of this, that God's main revelation to us as people is that we are all sinners. We have all sinned and fallen short of his glory. We have all done what we should not do, and we do not do what we should do. We've been separated from God as a result of our sin. And as a result of our sin, we merit judgment, punishment, and eternal separation from God. But we also miss out on an inheritance that is imperishable and kept in heaven for those who know God. So how do we know God? How do we come back into right relationship with us? Well, here we have an image of the cross, an image that reminds us of what Christ has done for us, in that on our behalf, he came to this earth. We just celebrated this a few weeks ago. God in the flesh came as a baby. He lived a perfect life, yet he was crucified. He was killed for the sins of the world. God made him who knew no sin to be sin for us, so that in him we might receive forgiveness and obtain the very righteousness of God. This is what we have to believe in if we are to obtain the inheritance. We have to recognize our sin. We have to recognize our utter desperation and our lack of hope without Christ, and come to him and confess our sinfulness and embrace his sinlessness, his perfection, and his suffering and dying and resurrection on our behalf. That because he lives, we can live also eternally. And we can know God, and we can be in right relationship with him. The very purpose of Christ dying was to bring us back to God. It was to accomplish that which we could not accomplish. And so if you believe in Christ, if you come to him even today and confess your sins and believe in this truth, believe in God's word and give your life to him, you will be forgiven. You will be restored into right relationship with God, and you can run and pursue the inheritance that he has called you to. And that inheritance is a sure and living hope that will not fade away. And so with the uncertainty of 2021 before us and the craziness of 2020 behind us, I encourage you to believe God's word, believe what he says, and take hold to that living hope. So the praise team will come up and I'll pray for us. And while I'm praying, they're going to come up and then we'll conclude and dismiss. Father, thank you for your word. Thank you for the living hope that you call us to, the inheritance that you give to us through Christ. Thank you for a sacrifice for us that we may be forgiven, completely forgiven, that our slate may be wiped clean, and that we can know you as a result of this forgiveness, Lord. Pray that you'd be with us in this year, that your word would be on our hearts and minds, and that it would be that which we share to other people, that we can impart to other people, so that we would always be those who have a reason for the hope that we have, that we can convey that reason and explain it to others. Lord, I pray that you would protect us and give us the strength of faith that we need to persevere through any trials, through any difficulties that we may face as well. Thank you that you're with us, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Great song choice, by the way. So, to carry on with the tradition, before we dismiss, I'll read this blessing over you. This is from Numbers 6, 24 through 26. It says, "May the Lord bless you and protect you. May the Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. May the Lord look with favor on you and give you peace." Happy New Year. Happy 2021, Royal Palms. We'll see you next week. Thank you. Amen.